Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Dear viewers, in the previous session, we began with topic number 15, which discusses some narratives on the incompleteness of the Quran. I had also introduced to you the two narratives that we're going to discuss under this topic. First of them is the stoning verse narrative, and the other one is the suckling verse narrative. I had also presented before you a representative text of the stoning narrative, the stoning verse narrative, and had elaborated before you that there are 10 ways, or the 10 different narratives in which this stoning verse, or narratives which speak of the stoning verse, have been transmitted. We have discussed the first of them. Inshallah, today we shall take up the rest of them and see how they stand to the test of historical criticism. So let me begin with the second one. We have discussed the first one earlier on. So the second one that I'm going to read out before you is recorded in the Muwatta of Imam Malik, and it is reported by Sayyid ibn al-Musayyib. He reports this narrative. So its Arabic text goes like this. And Sayyid ibn al-Musayyib annahu sami'ahu yaqul lamma sadara 'Umr ibn al-Khattab min Mina anakha bil abtah summa kawwama kawmatan batha summa taraha 'alayha ridaa'ahu wastalqa summa madda yadayhi ila as-samaa fa qala allahumma kabirat sinni wa za'afat quwwati wa intasharat ra'iyati فاقبزني إليك غير مزين ولا مفرط ولا مفرط ثم قدم المدينة فخطب الناس فقال يا أيها الناس قد سنت لكم السنن وفرضت لكم الفرائز وتركتم الألواضح إلا أن تضلوا بالناس يمينا وشمالا وضرب بإحدى يديه على الأخرى ثم قال إياكم أن تهلكوا عن آية الرجم أن يقول قائل لا نجد هدين في كتاب الله فقد رجم رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ورجمنا والذي نفسي بيده لولا ان يقول الناس زاد عمر بن الخطاب في كتاب الله وفي كتاب الله تعالى لكتبتها الشيخ والشيخة فرجموهما البتة فإن قد قرأناها. Yahya ibn Sa'id reports that he heard Sayyid ibn al-Musayyib say that when Umar returned from Mina, he made his camel sit at Al-Abtah. He then gathered some pebbles at one place and put his shawl over them to make a pillow, and lay down. He then raised both his hands towards the sky and said, God, I have grown old and have become physically weak, and my subjects have spread far and wide. Please give me death such that I do not waste your directives and commit excesses. He then came to Medina, gave a sermon to people thus, all practices have been made evident and all directives have been prescribed, and you have been left on a clear path except that you may drift away right and left. He then struck one of his hands on the other and said, beware of the worst of stoning, that someone says, we do not find both punishments, which of course refers to lashes and stoning, in the book of God. God's messenger did stone to death, and we also did so. I swear by him, in whose hands is my life, that had it not been for the fact that people would say that Umar has added to the book of Almighty, I would have written the words, "Ash-shaykhu wa shaykhatu farjumuhuma al-battata." We have indeed read these words. Viewers, you can now see the variance of this narrative being represented or displayed before you, and you can clearly see its various parts. Now, the above narrative is weak, and this is because at Umar's death, Umar ta'ala anhu's death, Sayyid ibn al-Musayyib, who is the madar, or the person who reports this narrative from him, he was only 8 years old, and this is clearly written in our biographical accounts. Hence, his narratives from Umar are regarded to be mursal, as has been pointed out by Yahya ibn Ma'in, Yahya ibn Sa'id al-Kattan, and he has pointed out this fact in various books, and specifically, I'd say, Jami al-Tahsil of Al-Alai says that his narratives from Umar ibn al-Khattab are mursal. Similarly, Abu Hatim and Al-Baji say that though he saw Umar, he did not hear narratives from him. So this again has been recorded in Alai. Alai's Jami al-Tahsin and Al-Baji's At-Ta'dil wa At-Tajri. So they say that although he saw Umar, but he did not hear narratives from him. It may also be interesting to note that in all the variants of the above narrative except one, Yahya ibn Sa'id reports from Sayyid ibn al-Musayyib. As you can see from the chart, that there is just one a variant in which this is not so. And in this exception, the narrative recorded, narrative recorded by Abu Nu'aym, Dawud ibn Abi Hind reports from Sayyid ibn al-Musayyib, and this narrative does not mention the stoning verse. So it is just a point to be noted that the other branch, which you can see the rightmost one, in which Dawud ibn Abi Hind reports from Sayyid ibn al-Musayyib and has been recorded by Abu Nu'aym, the stoning verse itself does not exist. But overall, as we can see, the basic problem in this narrative is that Sayyid ibn al-Musayyib is a person who relates mursal narratives from Umar ibn al-Khattab, and so therefore we cannot rely upon this narrative. Viewers, we now move on to the third narrative in this regard, and this narrative has been recorded by Ahmed ibn Hanbal in his Musnad, and it is reported by Kasir ibn al-Salt. The words are, and Kasir ibn al-Salt qala kana ibn al-As wa Zayd ibn Sabit yaktuban al-masahif fa marru ala hazihi al-aya فقال زيد سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول الشيخ والشيخة إذا زنيا فرجموهما البتة. Kasir ibn Salt said that Sayyid ibn al-As and Zayd ibn Sabit were writing masahif. They were as scribes, they were writing masahif. When they passed by this verse, Zayd said that he heard God's messenger say, الشيخ والشيخة إذا زنيا فرجموهما البتة. The famous stoning verse, he says that when they passed by this verse, Zayd said that he had heard God's messenger reading this verse. Now, the variance of this narrative also, viewers, can be represented in a schematic illustration, and you can see the schematic illustration being displayed before you. It is a rather comprehensive one and a very intricate one. Now, as you can see, there are various branches of this whole schematic illustration. Now, in the first section of the above narrative, Abu Dawud al-Tayalisi, who died in 204 Hijra, is suspect because of his memory. So, as you can see in the narrative, if you look, you see that Abu Dawud al-Tayalisi, who is in the first of these branches, he is suspect. And Al-Mizzi in his Tahzib al-Kamal records about him that in the opinion of Ibrahim ibn Sa'd al-Jawhari, al-Tayalisi has faltered in narrating 1,000 narratives. Ibn Sa'd's opinion about him is Sika Kathir al-Hadith Rubbama Ghalita. Abu Muhammad ibn Adi says that he would make errors in narrating 40,000 narratives he had in his memory. He would thus make some of them marfu, some mawquf, some he would provide with uninterrupted isnad, and some he would narrate in mursal form, and all of this would be because of his memory. So as you can clearly see that he is making certain narratives as marfu, others as mawquf, he is providing others with a muttasil isnad, and some he would narrate as mursal. So this was all because of his deficient or his faulty memory. Now, Ibn Hajar says, Siqa Hafiz Ghalita fi Ahadith. So this is what he says about Abu Dawud al-Tayalisi. Now, in the second section, viewers, move on to the second section of this chart, which is being displayed before you. As you can see, Amr ibn Hakam. So Amr ibn Hakam is the person who reports from Shurba, as is being indicated in the chart. So, in the opinion of Ibn Abi Hatim and Abu Zura, he is Laysa bil Khabi. Ibn Habban records, he would narrate narratives from trustworthy people which would not be narrated by other trustworthy narrators, and is La yuhtajju bihi if he is the sole narrator of a report. So, he cannot be adduced from if he is the only narrator. Ibn Hajar says that he would do tadlis from those whom he has not heard. He has recorded his opinion. This opinion has been recorded in Ibn Habban's Al-Majruhin. According to Al-Bukhari, he is Za'if, and in the opinion of Al-Nasai, he is Matrukul Hadith. So Al-Nasai in his Al-Zu'afa wal-Matrukin says that he is a person who is Matrukul of Hadith, who is a liar and therefore has to be forsaken because of this. Now viewers, let's move on to the third section of this narrative which is being displayed before you. Now in this third section, Muhammad ibn Yazid al-Rafa'i, as you can see, he is being indicated by the arrow before you. So Muhammad ibn Yazid al-Rafa'i is suspect. Al-Mizzi records, now I'm going to cite from Al-Mizzi, and this has been recorded in his Tahzib al-Kamal. Al-Bukhari says that he has seen narratives agreeing on his zurf. He has seen some authorities. He has seen some authorities agreeing. They think that he is a person who is za'if. An-Nasai says that he is za'if. Usman ibn Abi Shaybah says that he would steal narratives from others and narrate them. Abu Abdul Rahman, Abdullah ibn Umar, did not approve of him. Ibn Numair says he is the weakest amongst us in seeking knowledge and the one who narrates gharaib the most. Abu Hatim says that he is za'if, yatakallamuna fihi. So, which means that people are not satisfied with him, they have impugned him. Ibn Hibban says, yukhti wa yukhalif. Ibn Hajar records, and this he records in his Tehzeeb al-Tehzeeb, that according to Ad-Dar Qutni, the people of his city have objected to him. In the opinion of Al-Hakim, he is laysa bil-qawi. Ibn Hajar's own view about him is laysa bil-qawi. So this is as far as the third section is concerned. So in the fourth section, viewers, we find that Muhammad ibn Ja'far Ghundar, which is being indicated by the arrow, he is suspect. Ibn Hibban and Ibn Hajar say that he had a bad memory. And the words they use are ghaflatun fihi. So Ibn Hibban is a siqat, and Ibn Hajar in his Taqrib al-Tahzeeb say that he had a bad memory. Muhammad ibn al-Musanna says that he is mughaffalan, someone who forgets a lot. Yahya ibn Sa'id says that Muhammad ibn Ja'far was told that he was humiliated by the name of Shoba in these narratives. So this is what has been stated. The Yahya ibn Sa'id says that Muhammad ibn Ja'far was told that he was humiliated, that he has humiliated the name of Shoba in these narratives. So because Muhammad ibn Ja'far is the person, as you can see, he's reporting from Shoba in this variant. So the opinion of Yahya ibn Sa'id says that he is humiliated the name of his teacher by reporting this narrative. It may be noted that in the relevant variant of the narrative under discussion, it is Muhammad ibn Ja'far who narrates from Shoba. As I've already pointed this out, that he is a person who narrates from Shoba, and so therefore we find that he cannot be relied upon in this regard. Now, Ali ibn al-Madini says that he mentioned Ghundar before Yahya ibn Ma'in, and Yahya ibn Ma'in twisted his mouth as if he was regarding him as Za'if. And this has been reported in Al-Baji's At-Ta'dil wa Tajrih. Now, viewers, let's move on to the fifth section. In the fifth section, Sayyid ibn Abi Uruba is suspect. As you can see, he is the person who is reporting, and he's reporting from actually Qatada. He's suspect, and he was inflicted with a bad memory in his later age. This has been recorded by Al-Zahabi in his Tazkiratul Huffaz. Al-Uqayli records that according to Yahya ibn Sayyid al-Qattan, it was in that age that Muhammad ibn Adi, who narrates from him in this particular narrative, reports narratives from him. So this becomes even more clear now that Uqayli in his Az-Zu'afa al-Kabir says that Yahya ibn Sayyid al-Qattan, it was in this age, as you can see, that this in this particular age is that he reported narratives. So Muhammad ibn Adi reported from him. So he reported from Sayyid ibn Abi Uruba in this particular section. Now, viewers, let's move on to the sixth section of this narrative. It is the last of these. And here we find Abdullah ibn Humran as suspect. Ibn Hibban says, yukhti. Ibn Hajar says, saduqun yukhti kalilan. So, viewers, considering all these details, the narrative has to be consigned to the Hasan category. The Hasan category is the category which is below the Sahih category. And hence, although the narrative cannot be regarded to be a Sahih one, but it has to be relegated to the Hasan status. Next, viewers, let us move on to the fourth narrative in this regard. And this narrative has been reported in Abu Ubaid's Fazail al-Quran. And let me read out the narrative before you. It says, An Abi Umama ibn Sahal anna khalatahu qalat laqad aqra'na Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam ayat ar-rajm ash-shaykhu wash-shaykhatu idha zanaya farjumuhuma al-battata bima qazaya min al-lazza. So the maternal aunt of Umama ibn Sahal said, indeed God's messenger read out to us the verse of stoning, and then, as I said, the verse of stoning was read out as has been narrated. Now, the variance of the above narrative can be presented in the schematic illustration, which you can now see being displayed before you. And in this regard, this variant is extremely, the narrative is extremely weak because of Marwan ibn Usman. As you can see, viewers, he is the person who narrates from Abu Umama ibn Sahl. And Marwan ibn Usman is weak. Abu Hatim and Ibn Hajar record him to be Za'if. So this is the reason that I think that this narrative also, all the variants of this narrative are also weak and unreliable. Next, viewers, let's move on to the fifth narrative in this regard, which has been reported, and the one that I'm going to read out. This has been reported in Al-Bayqi's Sunan al-Kubra, and it has been reported thus. It is said that عن محمد قال نبئت عن ابن أخي كثير ابن سلط قال كنا عند مروان وفينا زيد بن ثابت قال زيد كنا نقرأ والشيخ والشيخة إذا زنيا فرجموهما البتة قال فقال مروان أفلا نجعله في المصف قال لا ألا ترى الشابين السيبين يرجمان قال كثير بن سلط وقال زيد بن ثابت ذكروا ذلك وفينا عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه قال أنا أشفيكم من ذاك قال زيد بن ثابت قلنا كيف قال أتى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فأذكر كذا وكذا فإذا ذكر الرجم أقول يا رسول الله اكتبني آية الرجم فقال أتيته فذكرته قال فذكر آية الرجم قال فقال يا رسول الله اكتبني آية الرجم قال لا أستطيع ذاك. So as I said, this has been recorded by Al-Bayhaqi in his As-Sunan al-Kubra. So Muhammad said, I was informed by someone from my nephew. You can clearly see that the person has not been mentioned. So I was informed. So the exact words are Nubbi'tu an ibn akhi Kaseer ibn Salt. So I was informed by someone from my nephew, Kaseer ibn Salt, who said, we were with Marwan and Zaid ibn Sabit was amongst us. Zaid said, we used to recite the words Ash-Shaykhu wa Shaykhatu Iza Zanaya Farjumuhuma Al-Battata. At this, Kaseer ibn Salt stated that Marwan said, should we not write it in the Musaf? Zaid said, no. Is it not your opinion that the two married people should be stoned to death? Kaseer ibn Salt stated that Zaid said, they mentioned this and Umar was amongst us. Umar said, I will fully satisfy you. Zaid said, how? Umar said, I used to go to the Prophet and would mention various things before him. And when the stoning verse was mentioned, I asked him, God's messenger, write down the verse of stoning for me. Once I came to him and mentioned the stoning verse to him. Zaid said, Umar mentioned the verse of stoning and said, messenger of God, write down the stoning verse for me. And the messenger of God replied, I cannot do this. And as I said, this has been recorded by Al-Bayhaqi in his Sunan al-Kubra. Viewers, the basic objection on this narrative is that it is munqata because of an unknown narrator between Muhammad and his nephew, Kaseer ibn As-Salt. So because of this inqita, we cannot rely on this narrative at all. Next, viewers, we move on to the sixth narrative in this regard. This has been recorded by Al-Khatib al-Baghdadi in his Al-Faqih wal-Mutafaqih. And it is said that the words are, قَالَ أُمُرْ رَزِي اللَّهُ عَنْهُ إِيَّاكُمْ أَنْ تَخْدَوُ أَنْ آيَةِ الرَّجْمِ فَإِنَّ نَبِيَّكُمْ قَدْ رَجَمَ وَرَجَمَ أَبُو بَكَرُ وَرَجَمْتُ وَلَوْلَا أَنْ يَقُولَ النَّاسِ زَادَ عُمُرُ بْنُ الْخَطَّابِ فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ لَكَتَبْتُهَا إِنِّي قَرَأْتُهَا فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ الشَّيْخُ وَالشَّيْخَةُ إِذَا زَنَيَا فَرْجُمُوهُمَا. Umar said, beware that you may be misled about the words of stoning. This is because your Prophet stoned criminals and Abu Bakr and myself also stoned. And were it not for the fact that people would say that Umar has added to the Book of God, I would have written it. I read it as Ash-Shaykhu wa Shaykhatu Iza Zanaya Farjumuhuma. So this is what has been reported. And as I said, this has been recorded by Khatib al-Baghdadi in his Al-Faqih wal-Mutafaqih. Now this narrative is weak, viewers, and since this narrative has only one variant, which is recorded by Khatib, the weakness is because of Khalid ibn Muhammad al-Ansari, who is found in the chain of narration of this narrative. Now, Az-Zahabi records, according to Ibn Adi, fi hadithihi ba'd al-Nukra. So they are known things which are unknown and less known things found in his narratives. Ibn Habban says that it is not permissible to adduce from him. This is what Az-Zahabi has recorded in his Mizan al-Itidal. Abu Hatim says he is laysa bil qawi, and as recorded by Lisan al-Mizan, Ibn Hajar Lisan al-Mizan, that Ibn Abu Hatim says that he is laysa bil qawi. Now, viewers, I come to the seventh narrative in this regard, and this seventh narrative has been reported by Ibn Zurais in his Fazail al-Quran. So it is reported thus, An Zayd ibn Aslam, An Umar ibn al-Khattab, خطب الناس فقال لا تشكوا في في الرجم فإنه حق قد رجم رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ورجم أبو بكر ورجمت ولقد هممت أن أكتب في المصحف فسأل أبي عن آية الرجم فقال أبي ألست أتيتني وأنا أستقرأها رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فدفعت في صدري وقلت أتستقرأه آية الرجم وهم يتصافدون تصافد الحمر. Zayd ibn Aslam said that Umar ibn al-Khattab delivered a sermon to people and said, do not have doubts about stoning. For it is the truth that God's messenger stoned criminals, and Abu Bakr and myself also did so. I resolved to write the stoning verse in the Mus'haf. So I asked Ubay about it. He replied, did you not once come while I was asking God's messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam to read it? So you had pushed my chest and said, you are asking him to read it while people are indulging in sex in an unrestrained manner like donkeys. So this is what has been reported, and as I said, it has been recorded by Ibn Zurayz in his Fazail al-Quran. Now, this for the simple fact that the above narrative does not have a complete isnad, it has just one variant which has been recorded by Ibn Zurayz. As you can see, it begins with An Zayd ibn Aslam. So there is no chain which goes all the way back to Ibn Zurayz himself. So he has reported a narrative which does not have a complete chain, and therefore whatever has been recorded in this narrative as such cannot be relied upon. Now we come to the 8th narrative in this regard, and this has been recorded in the Sunan of Ibn Majah. And this particular narrative has been reported by Aisha radiyallahu anha. And as you can see, it's text being displayed before you. I'm going to read it out before you. So it says, "An Aisha qalat laqad nazalat ayat al-rajm, laqad nazalat ayat al-rajm wa raza'at al-kabir ashran, wa laqad kana fi sahifatin tahta sariri. Falamma mata Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam wa tashaghalna bimawtihi dakhala dajinun faakalaha." Aisha stated, "The verse of stoning and suckling adults through 10 drops had been revealed and was written on a leaf beneath my bed. When God's messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam died and we became involved in his last rites, a goat entered and ate that leaf." And as you can see, the leaf it's allegedly have contained both the stoning and the suckling verse. As far as the suckling verse is concerned, this is something which is to be discussed later on. But as you can see, the complete narratives the variants of this narrative from Aisha radhiyallahu anha being displayed before you. Now, as far as this narrative itself is concerned, what needs to be understood is that Muhammad ibn Ishaq ibn Yasar al-Muttalabi, he is the madar, or he's the converging point of this narrative. And Az-Zahabi says that though some authorities have regarded him to be reliable, others have regarded him to be suspect. The opinions of Jar on him, I'm now going to reproduce them before you. So Az-Zahabi says that Ibn Ma'in says that though he is sika, yet he is laysa bihujja. And Nasai says that he is laysa bilqawi. Ad-Darqutni says that he is la yuhtajju bihi. Suleiman al-Timi, Yahya ibn Sayyid al-Qattan, and Hisham ibn Urwa regard him to be kazzab. He's a dirty liar. Abdul Rahman ibn Mahdi says that Yahya ibn Sayyid al-Ansari and Malik have impugned him. Malik, in the opinion of Yahya ibn Adam, has regarded Muhammad ibn Ishaq to be dajjal, that he is a dajjal. According to Ahmed, he indulges in tadlis a lot. Finally, summing up his own view, Az-Zahabi says that Muhammad ibn Ishaq is Hasan al-Hadith, Sali al-Hal, Saduq, and there are unique things in the narratives, in his narrations, which are not corroborated by others because he does not have a sound memory. While pointing to this last aspect, he says that such narratives of his should be regarded as munkar. So this has what been recorded by Az-Zahabi in his Sayr al-Alam al-Nubala. Ibn Abi Hatim records that in the opinion of his father, Abu Hatim, he is not al-Qawi fil-Hadith and he is Zayiful Hadith. So this is what Ibn Abi Hatim has recorded in his Al-Jarh wa Ta'dil. Now, Al-Mizzi records that when Ahmed ibn Hanbal was asked whether Muhammad ibn Ishaq's narratives, which are not corroborated by any other narration, be accepted, he replied in the negative and swore and said that he would narrate from a whole group of people, but would ascribe it to a single person and would not specify which part is from which particular person. So this has been recorded by Mazini's Tehzeebul Kamal. Ahmed ibn Hanbal is also reported to have said that his narratives about Maghazi can be accepted, but when it comes to what is allowed and prohibited, the haram and the halal, then reliable and trustworthy people are needed, and he is not among them. So this has been recorded in the Tariq of Yahya ibn Ma'in, as reported by Ad-Duri. Now, so a similar version of the above narrative is referred to by Zaylari in the following words thus, and this has been recorded by Zaylari in his Takhrij al-Ahadith al-Waqi fi Tafsir al-Kashaf liz-Zamakhshari. So the words are, وَرَوَى إِبْرَاهِيمُ الْحَرْبِي فِي كِتَابِ غَرِيبِ الْحَدِيثِ حَدَّثَنَا حَارُونُ بْنُ عَبْدِ اللَّهِ حَدَّثَنَا عَبْدُ السَّمَدِ حَدَّثَنَا أَبِي قَالَ سَمِعْتُ حُسَيْنًا عَنْ ابْنِ أَبِي بَرَدَى أَنَّ الرَّجَمْ أنزل في سورة الأحزاب وكان مكتوبة في خوصة في بيت عائشة فأكلتها شاتها. So this is what has been recorded. So I, although have not been able to find this narrative in the extant version of Gharib al-Hadith referred to by Zaylai, Ibrahim ibn Ishaq al-Harbi's Gharib al-Hadith, but this is what Zaylai has said. So let me analyze this narrative as well. Now viewers, this narrative is also weak. And the reason is that Abdus Samad ibn Habib ibn Abdullah, according to Al-Bukhari, is Layyinul Hadith. And he further says that Ahmed ibn Hanbal has recorded him in his Az-Zu'afa. Abu Zura al-Razi has recorded his name in his Az-Zu'afa as well. And Al-Uqayli records Abdus Samad ibn Habib ibn Abdullah's father, Habib ibn Abdullah, is Majhul. And you can see that he is also found in the chain of narration, as can be, because he's the person who says that qala samitu husaynan. So viewers, in the presence of this further data, we can see that this version, which is reported by Zaylai himself, is also suspect. So viewers, all in all, we have now today seen the remaining narratives, and some of the others inshallah we'll look up in the next episode of this topic, and we will then also see and critically analyze the suckling verse in the next episode. But till then, أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين والمسلمات.